Okay.
It wasn't that, it was a different aspect of your. You're saying you felt an SGA on the bus.
Oh, yeah, I think I'm sorry, but then I was like, you know what, I'm like, I'm not gonna move it, I'm gonna stay there for the lab.
Some more to see the birds. You guys have a meeting?
You guys have a meeting.
Dude, you guys have a meeting?
Yeah, last two, I'm like, I'm like, Friday.
So it's not just, you know, I'm.
Change this, what position? What position?
We're not going to Detroit?
Yes.
Oh, I said.
I know.
The resolution we passed last year to get a suggestion by Jennifer Nolan on the ballot. We submitted to late last year to get it on the ballot. So we changed the dates on the whole list.
If your president was how this.
Yeah, I just took Aisha's from last year and just changed the dates. They passed the Senate last year, but they passed the resolution. So I talked to Matt.
I'm like, if you say.
Sharp one on set. The question is, this is a.
Okay.
It's a very long.
$5 for the work.
Okay, that's the way to ease it. They actually, Craig?
Yeah.
Call this meeting to order on March 2nd, 2018 at 3:32 PM. Secretary Gregg, please call the roll.
President Kangin, Vice President Bedard, Treasurer Stevens, Speaker Capiti.
Here.
Senator Bartola.
Here.
Senator Bernard.
Here.
Senator Fink.
Here.
Senator Husnick. Senator Ida.
Here.
Senator Menominee.
Here.
Senator Mahoutia.
Here.
Senator Tolbert.
Here.
Senator Dowse.
Here.
Senator Howe.
Here.
Senator Martis.
Here.
Senator Shaheen.
Here.
Senator Hannah.
Here.
Senator Emery.
Here.
Senator L. Stacy.
Here.
Senator Schultz.
Here.
Senator Arrow.
Here.
Senator Isipano.
Here.
Senator Ballas.
Here.
Senator Mumbaugh.
Here.
Director Kelman. Director Spengros. Director Tirabassi. Director Bederson.
Here.
Director Moon.
Here.
Senator Bederson.
Here.
Senator Pritka.
Here.
Advisor Teasley.
Here.
Advisor O.
Here.
And Advisor Woodside.
Here. Okay. Any announcements? Senator Shaheen?
Hello. So Senator Pritza and I are working on our class voting guide. We are collaborating with Goodwill to get bins on campus, specifically in the Rec Center and in Fenn Tower in Newport Commons. So we are waiting on those bins to arrive. And then Director Moon is helping us with our marketing material. So once we get that finalized, we'll go ahead and get those on campus and right away, squared away. But before that, we're thinking about doing a raffle for the students that like want to possibly like take a selfie with their donations and send it to us. We're still figuring those details out, but we'll keep you guys updated and approve the message during the next meeting.
Okay, well, thank you for the update. Any other announcements? Okay, then there is an MSA event tonight, 6 o'clock, I believe. So I heard somebody talking about that. Sounds like it should be something good and paid for it. So. Next is ratification of meeting minutes. Can I get a motion to ratify the meeting minutes from the February 15th meeting? 16th meeting?
Motion to ratify the meeting minutes from February 15th.
16th.
16th.
Okay, can I get a second on that?
Second motion.
Okay, any discussion? Okay, any objections? Hearing none, the motion passes. Okay, moving on to new business. We have a very exciting update from the Division of Student Affairs. So yes, can you please welcome Claire Rockman here to give us a brief.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the time. Yes,
you're
perfect. Okay. First, thank you for letting me come and speak with you. I owe this organization an update. I worked with executive committee and some of you as individuals when our campus faced some bias events in the fall semester. And one of the outcomes of that was a change to our use of university facilities procedure related to posting information on campus. And so I wanted to review the change with you. I provided the entire document via a link so that you could review all of the information related to what the new procedures are for other things like reserving space, et cetera, et cetera. But I wanted to draw your attention to the section N, which is event promotion. And I wanted to talk through what was recommended and decided within a group of students, faculty, and staff. So the public bulletin boards that used to be in the student center that used to have credit card applications, I want to sell my car, I'm looking for a roommate, I'm playing in a bar, all of those kinds of random things on first floor, those are gone. because we discovered there isn't a means by which we can control the content on those boards if we call them public. So that meant that some of the information that on both ends of the political spectrum and on both ends of the human rights spectrum, we would not have an ability to say, no, we don't want that, because we've advertised them as public. So we took a different approach, and we've identified our campus and our bulletin boards as campus information. And so therefore, what can be posted on the bulletin boards that conference services handles are things about campus events and campus announcements. So SGA elections, the MSA event you just spoke about, all of those things, which has really been 99% of what's posted on the boards anyway, we're now asserting under procedure that that's what we'll permit to have posted. The other change is that you now have to drop them off in person, and you need to have contact information on the poster for who's sponsoring the event. Sounds practical. You want credit if you were SGA for the event that you were doing. But some groups were interested in posting information and not taking responsibility for that being their opinion or their voice. And so now you have to drop them off at conference services, and they're reviewed right then. And if they are not a campus event, they'll be given back to you. So if you're playing in the flats with a band of your roommates, we're going to say, I'm sorry, that's not campus information. Okay? If faculty members are performing in a barbershop quartet, sorry, I'm dating myself, we would tell them the same thing. If it's off campus, it's not a campus event, and it can't be advertised on our bulletin boards. I don't see this as a major impact to the marketing that's done by student organizations, candidly, because social media is still wide open for all of you to make your own decisions about. And so really, posters are a pretty outdated way of communicating. So again, we're doing this simply so that organizations take responsibility, and we think that that's a positive. It had a lot of support from the students we were working with in the fall, and I hope that as you're thinking through it, or if people ask you about it, we try to stay in that common sense realm. What's reasonable, okay? The other piece is that they're only up for 2 weeks, okay? That's just never been said before, and people would get upset because they dropped them off a month before, they'd go up for 2 weeks, and then they weren't there. So we clarified, okay? The new piece of information that hasn't been communicated as clearly as it might is that conference services only controls between 12 and 15 bulletin boards on campus. The majority of those are in main classroom. Colleges, departments, and offices control all the rest. And so if you have all of your classes in the Monte Nehusia building, then you need to speak to the college about using their bulletin board. Okay? If you're over on the other side of campus and you're in Jolka Hall, and you want to post something in the area that's typically used by the School of Nursing, you're going to need to ask the School of Nursing. Okay? And in Jolka, because they have electronic bulletin boards as well in Jolka, that's also the process by which you could get something posted on those electronic boards. Okay? Does anybody have any questions?
I'm just curious, if it is an event that is on campus but in collaboration with like an off-campus organization such as Campus District, would that be something that would be approved or not approved?
You know, that excellent question. So there are three types of organizations that can reserve space, okay? So there's university organizations, which is the student organizations and departments and colleges all together, okay? There's an external organization, which would be Campus District in most situations. And then there's what's called in the policy now a partner organization. And a partner organization is identified through a letter of support to conference services by a dean, a vice president, or somebody on the president's cabinet. Typically the provost gets involved in this. Typically deans, associate deans get involved in saying, that's a great idea. Let me notify conference services that campus districts. And so the other part of that is that the external units that do get space reserved here do have permission to post, but their options are more limited. So we generally don't reserve space to entities that are coming here that don't want to communicate with students. So if Ambassador Greetings is holding a staff meeting, we really don't need happy Ambassador Greeting cards all over campus saying, welcome Ambassador Greetings. You know what I mean? So as an example, but that would be how it would work for you if you were partnering with campus district.
So sometimes we market our events for 2 weeks. What happens to that marketing material? Can we take it back and resubmit it?
You know, that is a great question, and I owe you an answer to that because I don't know.
I can follow up through email.
Yeah, that would be great. And I'm at C.RAHM if you want to send me other questions.
I'll send you guys the link to this and her email address as well if you have any more questions.
Yeah, because as you read the complete document, which, oh my gosh, I'm not doing on a Friday afternoon. Please feel free to say, I'm the point person for anything else that comes up as a question. Anything else? Thanks very much. Catherine, do you have anything else from Student Affairs?
I have
not to put you
two,
on.
Two things.
Okay.
So
can I share the floor?
Yes, of course. Thank you.
Absolutely.
So I apologize that I don't have the exact details, but as you know, I've been your interim advisor for student affairs, but very exciting because next week your new advisor will be on campus doing her interviews. So there's 4 interviews scheduled, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday for next week. And if anyone is interested, they need students to go to lunch with the candidates, and they need students to go to presentation. All the candidates will give a presentation. So their presentation is in something along the line of how can student engagement increase retention at Cleveland State. So I believe the presentations are at 2:15 in the afternoon. I can send you all an email, or if you want to reach out to me if you're particularly interested in going to lunch. So you get to go to Elements and get a free lunch and talk to the candidates about how great Cleveland State is. But we'd like to have as many students as possible go to lunch and as many students as possible go to the presentation as well. So if you're interested in either of those, that's happening next week. So every day but Wednesday next week. So if you have one day next week. So yeah, thanks.
All right, thank you. And that's really important.
Yeah, so you're choosing your new advisor.
Please go. Even if you're not going to be involved next year, leave it in good hands. So, up next is the Matt Martis Show. He's got 2 different things to talk to you about. First off, some finance info since Kyle isn't here. And then we're going to be transitioning to some Board of Elections talk real quick. So, here's this.
Hi guys, so we just need the Senate to ratify the finance allocations from Tuesday's meetings. These have already been passed and seconded in the Finance Committee, so.
What's the date on that?
February 27th. Oh, so that was the day of the Finance Meeting, the deliberations from Tuesday.
Okay. So, anybody have any questions about this at all? Do you want to walk us through real quick?
Yeah, so we approved the total of $51,000, and we approved a total of $4,572 from the collaborations fund.
Okay. Does it say on there at all? Okay, but,
it does not. I don't have those
documents. We know that we had quite a bit of room in our budget at this point, so no, we don't. Well, that's kind of Kyle talking on this. Okay, so.
If you want me to talk.
Yes, I would love
to. Okay. So how it's right now, we're waiting for groups to give us receipts back. So there's very, very minimal to distribute out until we know that student groups haven't spent their funds that they were given. So until that number is updated, there's potential that there won't be a last funding hearing because most of the money, the number that's sticking out in my head is there's $4,000 left to allocate out, but that could be I believe there is a lot of funds because people didn't spend all their money, but until they tell us, they for sure didn't.
Yeah. Okay. So we spent much less than we allocated. All right. Well, really wish I was here today. That's fine. The committee has
seen it fit to fund these organizations. Yes, am I sorry?
I move to ratify the funding, finance allocations from the Tuesday finance meeting.
That's not gonna work. February 27th. Yes.
I move to ratify the finance allocations from the Tuesday, February 27th.
Okay, any objections? Discussion we already had? All right, hearing none. It passes. Congratulations, Aaron. Thank you. Next is going to be some BOE stuff.
Yeah, so today we're doing the ballot holder drawing. So the way this is going to work is I'm just going to draw these names around the top of the hat. Each candidate has their name in this Viking helmet. So how it's going to be on the ballot is the executive parties are going to be placed first. So whichever candidate's name I draw, if they are a member of an executive party, that executive party will be first, and so on and so forth. And then the senators will be second, the judicial will be third. You can if you want. Yeah, I was going to be more than one. All right, so the first one is Maria Tarabostik is a member of LEADA Students. So that party will be the first executive party on the ballot. Next is McKenna Dowse, which she's running for Senate. Next one is Milla Caprica, did I say that right? Melissa. Okay. Next one, Erica Pedersen from Student Advocates. Omar Wadan running for Senate. Dugesh Padarajmi, you're a student, so that's already on there. Megan Kellerman for Senate. Glenn Parker for Judicial Board. He's actually the only one running right now, so I gotta be like, yeah. Danielle Malhalsia for Senate. Cameron Tolbert for Senate. For Senate. Alyssa Tarabosky for Senate. Emily Stankovic from 1CSU. Donna Shaheen for Senate. Tina Vestola for Senate. Chloe Zivkak for Senate. All right, guys.
last year, we attempted to have our constitution updated. We have like a lot of purely grammatical errors. We have some issues with seats not being updated to reflect the names of colleges, things like that. And last year we got really hung up on it, and we didn't pass it. We didn't update a lot of really important stuff. So we're gonna try it again this year. The things that are highlighted in yellow are all of the things that are changed. And I can go through and explain those to you, and I will. At the end of every at the end of every article that I go through, I want us to talk about it. Any issues that you have with it, let's go back. But let me finish the article, and then we'll go back and talk about it. And at the end, we're going to move over to see if we ratify this new constitution, okay?
Cool.
Good. All right, let's start. First things first, new email address, because the other one literally didn't exist. Everyone cool with that one?
Wonderful.
Okay, let's keep it moving. All these red lines are changes in spacing. I hope you don't have to go through that at all. I'm gonna make an executive decision not explaining all of those to you guys. So down here, it talks about like what students and what positions there are, so I can go through and read those to you, but basically it defines, so one undergraduate senator is chosen for each of the four class days at the university. It tells you all those things, and then at the end we just added the Speaker of the Senate, because we hadn't defined that at all in the Constitution. So that's just an easy thing that we put in there. It's something that I believe Aisha made that edit last year and saw it as important. Up next, we changed the name from the Fenn Engineering Senator, or the Fenn College of Engineering, so Washington's College of Engineering, which is now the name. So that just needed to be updated very quickly. Am I moving too fast for you guys? Are you all good? All right. Next, this only said, I believe this only said Urban College, so we just filled out the full name here. We also did for the School of Nursing, we just changed it to the correct titles that they used. So, hope that's cool with everyone. This was just a one word change. We're just talking about how the dress code will be that I should put in. It's just the word for clarification. She added a period at the end as well. Up next is this section. So the Senate can overturn a veto of the SGA president with an affirmative vote equal to 2/3 of all voting members in the Senate. The Senate has until the following Senate meeting to vote to overturn said veto. In case the veto is occurring less than 48 hours before the Senate meeting, the Senate has until the next two Senate meetings to overturn. So this one was purely phrasing as well. This has been our policy. I hope that it will remain our policy. We've run into very few vetoes, but if we did, that's how we would handle it. So a lot of this edit right here had to do with making sure that it is known that the SGA secretary is in charge of committees, which is obviously very important and wasn't always the policy. So I'll read that section for you. Each senator is required to serve on at least one, but no more than three SGA standing committees, as well as at least one university standing committee. For purposes of this section, trial committees contained in the operations manual should be considered SGA standing committees. Ad hoc committees shall be considered SGA standing committees. However, discretion lies with the SGA secretary regarding whether a senator may use an ad hoc committee as a standing committee report. So this is what I was unaware of for a while. Up next is section 16, which reads, senators may earn a student leadership award as set forth in the SGA operations manual and stated in the Senate position description. This has always been our policy, once again, just rephrasing. So I've left this crossed out. This obviously won't be on the official copy, but I just wanted you to see like what we removed. So this was an edit by error. So the director's policies and procedures shall report directly to the Speaker of the Senate. The position description can be found in the SGA operations manual. We found that this was redundant to
have like specific numbers for how many seats there are for each set position?
Not outlined here.
Okay, that's somewhere right here?
Yes.
Doesn't it change? It like changes every year depending on.
We have a formula.
Okay.
For the show.
Okay.
But it's not defined as such.
Okay, gotcha. So.
That's not an operations.
Okay, thank you.
So everybody's cool with that section. We're going to have any problems there. Any other application? Okay, let's move on to the next one. You're sticking with me here again. This is what's the blue moon kind of thing. Okay, let's start off with section two here. The cabinet acting in an advisory capacity shall consist, but is not limited to, the e-board, director of academic affairs, director of student affairs, director of finance, director of policies and procedures, director of marketing, director of technology, and director of governmental relations. So I know that we don't have all of those positions right now operating, and that's why we put in the wording of what is not limited to. So it doesn't have to consist of all of those, it consists of just some of those. So the executive board kind of has a discretion to use whatever directors they think is okay. Does anyone have any questions about that part at all? It just gives a little more flexibility to whoever's in charge. Okay, moving on. So the SGA president, this is section four, the SGA president shall have powers to establish and maintain operating procedures for the executive branch, veto within 5 calendar days any legislation which passes the Senate. All meetings, including joint meetings of the cabinet and the board, establish ad hoc committees and answer for all actions of the executive branch. The president shall appoint members of the student appointment board at the first Senate meeting of his term. In the case that the student appointment board cannot meet before the Senate ratification is needed, the president may make a recommendation to the Senate to make a motion. Responsibilities of student leader scholarship shall be further outlined in position description set forth in the SGA operations manual. Yes.
Oh, I was just going to jump back.
Okay. Almost done here. No, the offices and facilities of SGA are available only to members of the e-board, senate, and officers of officially recognized student organizations with express the purpose of conducting business through an SGA. That has always been our policy. It's something that allows. I use just like a locker room. I think it's something that's really great. Also, you have a question?
Yeah, so I just wanted to clarify my position, and I don't really care one way or another. So the title, and I was just double checking it, the title and the job description is graphic design and marketing, and here it's marketing. I don't care one way or another. I just want to throw it out for consistency's sake, whether you want to change the job description or the constitution.
So that would be all the agents. Right now, director of marketing is an apt to report, I believe, and committee believed. So we can go back later and change those other documents to it. But we're not getting through that today.
No, perfectly fine. I just wanted to clarify because, when you put the graphic design component on it, it completely changes the position.
Sure.
So just wanted to throw that out there, whether it's now or later.
Yeah, and that's something that we'll take note of when we're making our recommendations for, you know, position descriptions and things like that. So appreciate that. Anyone else have any questions about that section at all? Section four? Or sorry, Article four. Okay. On to Article five. Section one, SGA senators holding scholarship within SGA shall have and maintain a minimum overall grade point average of 2.5. While the E-Board, Cabinet, Speaker of the Senate, and the Speaker of the Senate must maintain a 3.0 on a 4.0 scale. All SGA members shall have and maintain a minimum overall grade point average of 2.5. I want to address this real quick because this is the most hotly contested thing in our committee meeting. What this is effectively doing is raising us to a higher standard. Yes?
When I'm all for that one, I just think these were set in place by, correct me if I'm wrong, Kevin, is this just like a student leadership scholarship thing?
Yeah, to get your scholarships, you have to have a 2.5 QM and semester.
So that's our reason why it was there, so I think that's what it was called.
I shouldn't have ever written on the committee meeting. Can we kind of all agree on this compromise?
Fine, we'll increase it. You just can't decrease it.
Okay, gotcha.
Can't go down to a 2.
Yeah, so we can talk about this in a minute, but we'll just go through once again. That raises the overall grade point average needed by a senator from a 2.0 to a 2.5 and raises the E-Board minimum to a 2.5 to a 3.0. I think that's very realistic as student leaders in the classroom and outside the classroom. And I think it's a compromise that we felt wasn't exclusive in any way, but also held us to a higher standard. So anybody have any discussion on that? Section 2, the Director of Policies and Procedures, in consultation with the SGA advisor, is responsible for ensuring all SGA members maintain the qualifications stated in Section 1. If any SGA member fails to meet the requirements of Section 1, said SGA member shall be removed from office with formal notification to the Senate by the Speaker of the Senate. Standing committee voting privileges, except in the case of a tie, if appropriate, an SGA member may be deemed see 9 students, each standing committee should have a space up to 6 voting SGA members and 3 spaces for non-SGA students. So that has been our policy. Just need a little rephrasing of a non-SGA student then, and then period here. So pretty easy changes. Let's go to standing committees. So standing committees shall meet based on schedule set by the SGA applications manual. Section 6 outlines those standing committees as diversity, community outreach, finance, investigation, legislation, public policy, public relations, Senate application review board, or SAR, student appointments board, and United Student Organizations. United Student Organization hasn't been used this year or the year before that, but we decided to give that option to everybody that, hey, if you want to use this in the future, you don't want to get rid of this from your constitution. Nobody says you have to use it. I just think it's something nice that we put in there. So these are all the active committees right now. Okay, moving on to the Finance Committee. This group just addresses how to handle non-SGA members who are voting members of the Finance Committee. So non-SGA student members of this committee with voting rights shall be active in at least 2 recognized CSU student organizations. No student organization other than SGA should be represented by more than 1 non-SGA voting member on this committee. No voting member of the Finance Committee shall vote on the proceedings of an organization which they are a member, which is just pretty basic right there. The other thing is, when it says, this was a change from 1 to 2. So we just want the students who are coming and getting involved in our Finance Committee to not come here with 1 loyalty. We want people that are coming out from school, we want people that are involved. So we bumped that up to getting involved in 2 organizations. Anybody have an opinion on that? Assignments shall be made during the second Senate meeting of the fall semester. Committee assignments shall also be made during the second meeting of the spring semester.
section already in here about what happens in the event the SGA president is unable to serve. So this is kind of our emergency clause. This actually does not need to be read because it is in the Constitution right now. In the first edit of the Constitution that we went through last year with all of you that did not pass, this was crossed out. So we brought this back this year. It's just a bunch of contingency plans for, like, you know how nobody knows if the president and the vice president and the secretary say, like, if they all get assassinated, who takes over? It's like that for student government. It's like, what happens if all of you quit? How would we fill these roles? And God forbid, we'll never have to use these. But if you want to take a closer look at it, they are in our original Constitution. Section 8, if a seated member is not able or willing to take executive office, the president shall advertise for the position media for a period of 2 to 4 weeks. The president shall then recommend from the qualified applicants a new officer who will serve out the remaining term of office. The appointment shall require an affirmative vote of 2/3 of all the Senate members present. So this is pretty easy. This means if Olga quit and Aisha couldn't get any of you to fill the role, then we can look outside of SGA. Once again, never gonna. Prior to the removal vote, the INL committee shall present the charges that were filed to the Senate, the result of their investigation, and any evidence related to the charges that were discovered in the process of the investigation in the form of a formal recommendation to the Senate. So that's what I did with you guys this year. So we talked about what happened, what was done wrong, and then we did a formal understandable charges ahead of time before the INL meeting or the Senate meeting when the INL recommendation is made. So that's just giving someone fair time to come up with ideas about how to defend themselves or what they're going to do different in the future. So I think that's fair. I think that's something that we have been careful to do. Anyways, any questions about that article? I know that was a short one. Period. Senators shall attend all SGA meetings as a courtesy. In anticipated absences should be communicated to the speaker at least 48 hours prior to the scheduled meeting time or emergencies. So I really appreciate that for the rest of this year. You guys give me a little bit more heads up. I think 48 hours is fair. You should know your work schedule before that and stuff like that. So this area was senator in violation shall have the option of
requesting an appeal hearing to present reasons why he slash she shall not be removed from office. A written request for an appeals hearing shall be made to the speaker no later than 3 business days from the date of suspension. We changed it from a week to 3 days because we figured if you were really upset about getting your suspension, then you'd probably respond within 3 days. Not that that's asking too much of it, because a week goes on, there could be another meeting, there could be some issues for are they qualified to sit here? What happens if he hasn't filed his appeal, so we have to wait another meeting? So these are all things that we don't want to have to run into for the future, and that's why we made that change.
Policy to an academic year, you might get to change it from academic term to academic.